All right. So how you been, brother? How you been, man?
I've been good other than this little injury here.
Yeah, man. I got the email. I don't know all the details. I don't know if you want to talk about it or not, but yeah, so I got all the details out and I was shook. I'm like, "Wow, that's crazy. We're supposed to do an interview on that Saturday," you know? Yeah. Could you want to talk about that or you can't talk about that?
Man, I don't want to get too much off of details, but yeah, I got shot. I really don't know where it came from. So, I mean, all these conspiracy theorists been seeing me do these interviews exposing Illuminati and Jay-Z and shit. So
Right, 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 yeah.
they all think it came from that. Me being in the streets all my life, it ain't no telling. I don't got no real serious street beef, so it
Right.
surprised me. So I really don't know what came from, but I ain't gonna just cancel out all the possibilities. Like it could have been some government shit. I've been threatened by the government.
Right.
I had death threats by the government. Like literally, that's to my lawsuit. If you look up my lawsuit, case number 17 CV 1192 in the Eastern District of Wisconsin, you will see that it's documented that the government basically threatened to kill me and or to incarcerate me for life if I refuse to be informed. And so I refused to be informed, and they framed me as a member of a drug trafficking organization, basically tried to give me a conspiracy for that. They failed. I got out. I sued them. I won. So they could have a vendetta. It ain't no telling.
So, did you? I mean, did somebody like, did you see anybody? Or, I mean,
That's the thing, because I've been in the streets all my life, and I know how I get down. I know how I go. Like usually when it's something involved in the streets, you're not gonna hear one shot and not just like, damn, where that come from? Like
okay. So it's
in the
like one
street.
shot then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, man, that's crazy, man. You got to be careful out there, man. Seriously. Yeah, 'cause you never know. You know what I
Yeah, for
mean? Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I was surprised to hear that though, man. I mean, so how you feeling though? You feeling, I mean, you good? I mean,
Now, I'm in
your
good
nerves and
spirit.
everything, you know what I'm saying?
I'm in good spirit. My arm was like dead for a while, and the doctors, they actually told me that I probably wouldn't be able to feel nothing for 2 weeks, and I'm already like it's been times that I won't even wear my sling. And I
Right,
can move
right.
my arm, but then it'd be like that pain to hit. Or I'll feel a certain crap. It'd be like, hold on, let me stop playing. Let me put the sling on.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Wear that sling, man. Seriously, dang. Yeah, I had a cousin get shot. I want to say a couple months ago, man. And yeah, I'm like, wow, dude. You blessed. You blessed. You never know. You know what I mean? Yeah, it could have went left real quick as far as bullets go, you know.
Paul Arnold was dead.
Okay, so man, let's get right into it, man. What's your feelings about R. Kelly, man? I mean, you think he's a good guy? Because I told you before, I kind of stopped listening to his music, but at the same time, I don't listen to a lot of music these days, but if a R. Kelly song come on and if they don't come on the radio anymore, you know what I mean? So you have to go and actually look for it. But yeah, that's how I felt about it. But I mean, it goes a little bit deeper than that. But how do you feel about the dude, man? You got to know him and thing while you were there and incarcerated with him. So how do you feel about the dude, man? Like, how do you? I'm trying to put the words together right. What's your feelings on him? You know what I mean?
Well, I noticed you a book author like myself, so
Yeah.
I feel like conscious black men like us should be more aware of government propaganda and manipulation. And I feel like this situation is a case of government propaganda, media manipulation, and they trying to paint this picture of him that he monster, a pedophile. And I think, you know, when we look at the fact that Tupac was framed as a rapist, Kobe Bryant was framed as a rapist.
Yeah, Mike Tyson, Bill Cosby,
you know what I mean?
The list goes on and on, yeah.
Not even a coincidence no more, so even Michael Jackson allegedly was, you know, molesting kids, you know, so.
Yeah.
I think we got to be a little more open-minded, at least those of us like us. You know, I looked at some of the titles of your books. I haven't read one yet, but from my perspective, I believe that you are a conscious black man like myself. So
absolutely.
That those of us who are awakened like that, I think that we should be looking at the situation a little different, you know. But I never really looked at him, even before I met him, I never really looked at him as what they portray him as on Surviving R. Kelly. And, you know, getting to know him, you know, he seemed like a very God-loving man. He down to earth. And I looked into this case, and, you know, I was framed as a member of a drug trafficking organization. So me looking at it, I seen a lot of similarities of like how they basically was trying to frame him as something. And the crazy thing is that he wasn't charged for none of the things that was alleged on Surviving R. Kelly.
Yeah.
We got to be aware of that.
Right. Now, I started watching that. How many is it now? Like three seasons of it? I started watching it, and I'm like, man, this is really, really disturbing. You know what I mean? And it almost seemed like, I'll just say it seems real fishy, man. It just seems real fishy. Why is he the only one in jail? You know what I mean? You know, it wasn't anybody else that you know, went, you know, it was other people around him, I'm sure. So nobody else got charged for anything. That's like the biggest thing for me, man.
I mean, even with Jay-Z's situation, you know, he came out with Foxy Brown.
Yeah.
You know, his first hit was with Foxy Brown, you know, and she was about 15. You know, allegedly he was having sex with her while she was 15, 27. And
right.
This is something that has been known, but people bash R. Kelly because he was allegedly, you know, having sex with Aaliyah, but nobody said nothing about Jay-Z allegedly having sex with Foxy Brown while she was the same age, you know what I mean?
Right, yeah. So, I mean, yeah. So how long were you incarcerated with him, man? And were you guys, like, cellmates, or were you, like, just on the same, were you guys in the same unit? Or how was that?
No, he was on Unit 19 for most of his time there. His first month or two, he was on protective custody. But, you know, me and a few other guys put out a word that he would be safe on general population with us. So,
right.
He had his lawyer put in the paperwork and got him for population. But I was on Unit 15 at the time at MCC Chicago, on Unit 19 at the time. And we first, you know, crossed paths in the medical unit. We was called down at the same time and day. And then I was sent to the hole, you know. I got a lawsuit about this particular incident, but the Bureau of Prisons staff, they basically tried to kill me, and, and sent me to the hole. I didn't have no incident report, so I wasn't supposed to be down there. When I got out the hole, they moved me up to 19, where R. Kelly was at.
Okay. So
that's when we, you know, was able to, like, communicate a lot more. But even when we wasn't on the same unit, you know, he might say, I still got a copy of one of his kites, matter of fact. Or, you know, I sent kites to him, you know what I mean? So we stayed in communication while I was there June of 2019 to May of 2021. And I think he either came in like August or September. So he was probably there at least 20 months while I was there.
Right.
Or a little more, probably 20 to 21 months or something while I was there.
Okay. So, yeah, I got to give a little more pushback, though, man, because, you know, I think I started hearing about the Aaliyah R. Kelly thing, like, when Aaliyah first came out when she was 15. And since then, it's been one thing after another, you know what I'm saying? It's always something, like, at least once a year, you're going to hear about R. Kelly and some young girls and things like that. So do you think he's remorseful for anything involving, like, younger girls? You know what I mean? Do you think he's, like... he might be looking back like, you know what, I could have done some things different. You see what I'm saying?
I mean, I don't think he, I mean, from my recollection and what I know.
Because you got fans out there like me and many other people, man, that really, the dude was, my personal opinion, I think he was a genius, you know. You know, and I just want to try to understand what's going through his mind. Because I you know, well, you got smoke, there gotta be some fire there, you know what I mean?
Sorry about that. Like,
yeah, so how do you think you think there's any kind of remorse with the guy?
Well, I don't know nothing about him having sex with no underage females. I know he dealt with a few females that you can consider young, probably 19, 21, you know.
Right.
So I don't know nothing about him being remorseful. I mean, I 19 year olds, 20, you know what I mean? I'm mid 30s, so I don't have no remorse for that. I mean, the ones I dealt with was developed, mature, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
There's nothing, is legal, you know what I mean? So I don't feel remorseful about it, and I don't think he has no reason to feel remorseful about having sex with a 19-year-old or a 21-year-old.
A legal adult, yeah. Okay, I got you.
But I don't know nothing about no underage shit, if you ask. No, I don't know nothing about it.
Right, I got you. Did he ever talk about his family, you know what I'm saying, his wife and kids, while you conversated with him?
No, he spoke about how, you know, a lot of his close friends and family betrayed him, and he basically was explaining that because, you know, I could tell that he didn't really trust me. I was trying to get him to sign an agreement to allow me to write a book on his side of the story. So he didn't know whether I was out to get him or what. So he just basically explained, like, man, I don't know. It sounds like a good idea, but, man, I done been messed over by my closest people. You know what I'm saying? So
right.
I don't know what to do. I don't feel like I could trust you. You know what I mean? He didn't really directly say he don't know if he could trust me, but, you know, basically that's what he was trying to explain.
Okay, so I said something earlier. I kind of jumped the gun a little bit, but I truly do think the guy's a genius. Like I told you a few days ago, I went back and I listened to a few of his songs, and his ability to write his lyrics, and you see, you know, he's a producer, and so I mean, what's your personal opinion on that? You think he's a genius? You know what I mean? Like when it comes to music, because they say the guy's illiterate, but I just don't see how a person who can be illiterate write the type of music that he writes.
I think he's the greatest songwriter of all time. Including myself, I'm a songwriter, and I still do think highly of myself, but I haven't heard any music that was more well put together than some of R. Kelly's songs, so. I think, you know, like, he got a song out called The World Greatest. And even in my song, I got a song out called Free R. Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
He's speaking at the end, and I basically tell him, man, you still the world's greatest, you know what I mean? And I really believe that.
Yeah, it's a shame, man, when, you know, we have, like, you know, our black artists, like some of our best. I don't think it's a coincidence that, you know, Bill Cosby, R. Kelly, Michael Jackson, you know what I mean? These are some of our best artists and comedians and actors and athletes go down for stuff like this. I don't get it. You know what I mean? It's like either we're just innately bad people, you know what I mean? Just born bad people, or it's something bigger to the picture that we're not privy to see. That's what I'm leaning to. While you were there with him in prison, was there any type of like incidents, fights or inmates trying to get at him for certain things, or was it, I see you smiling a little bit, so it must have been something.
No, it was one situation, but I really don't. I wasn't on a unit with him at the time, so I didn't see it. But this was while I was on Unit 6. This was during the COVID pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
We had locked down for months. They had deprived us of everything, hours to ordering food, to making phone calls. So, you know, we was going through it in there. And the week that they had opened up, coincidentally, this same week, people started protesting on R. Kelly's behalf. And I guess they have an institution rule when people protest, it's a security risk. So they was locking us down. They had locked us down 3 days in a row. And this was the week where, you know, we was just now getting excited about being able to make a phone call again or take showers again regularly. So the whole building was upset with R. Kelly at the time. So when it happened, everybody just felt like, you know, this guy named Jeremiah Farmer did it, you know. Mm-hmm. He just felt like, you know, he did it to take one for the team, you know what I mean? Because
okay.
Everybody was frustrated with R. Kelly in there at the time, including me. So,
and you know, said he did what now? Because I missed that.
I said everybody was frustrated with R. Kelly in there at the time because, you know, they was locking the institution down because of his people coming up there to protest on his behalf.
Okay.
So we felt like that's why Jeremiah Farmer did it. But
he did. I missed that. You said he did what?
He basically whooped R. Kelly ass.
Oh, shit. Really? Oh. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Ah, man, that's the first time hearing that. When you saw him there, was it after the Gayle King interview?
Yeah.
That was after, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Did he speak about that?
Not really. It's crazy because I seen you on that platform too, Hip Hop Uncensored.
Yeah, Hip Hop News Uncensored. Yeah.
That's why I tried to postpone our interview to tomorrow because I had that scheduled with them. But I just did an interview with them, and they had some of these same things. But
oh, really?
Yeah, and I seen you on there because I was looking at some of their previous interviews, and you had like an ad on there. That's how
yeah.
I used a book author.
Yeah. Yeah.
So shout out to them, man, and salute you for your books. I'm gonna order some of your books too. Some of them sound very interesting.
Yeah. Okay, that's cool, man. Yeah. Old God and Sam Ant, man. Those are good dudes over there, man. Hip Hop News Uncensored and Viral Hip Hop News, man. Yeah, those brothers hold me down, man. They really hold me down when it comes to interviews. Commercials, I mean. Yeah. So so he didn't say anything about that Gayle King interview? To you, I mean,
not really. He just was, not really. You know, I done bashed enough, but he did feel like he did say something about how Gayle King and Oprah and them was like government puppets.
Okay.
You know, they controlled by certain Jewish mafias who run the media and the music industry. You know, stuff like that. And He felt like he was basically saying he really didn't even want to be interviewed, but like his publicist or something.
Yeah.
I guess Gayle and them got in his publicist's head, probably even paid him on the side and convinced R. Kelly, you probably need to speak out. And, you know, he was going through so much at the time, he said that he really didn't want to do it.
And right. Doing an
interview. You know, Gayle King, she trained. They trained her well.
How yeah, to, yeah.
You know, upset and frustrate somebody. And you know, R. Kelly, you know, he a good dude, but he not as strong mentally as, you know, somebody like me, you know, who can speak through all the manipulation.
Right. Yeah, and like I told you, man, I think that all of that stuff could have been edited out. The world didn't have to see that. You know what I mean? So why would you show that? Why would you ask questions like that about Kobe Bryant? You know what I mean? That's you know, that's that type of stuff. It makes me think a lot. You know.
If I lash out doing this interview, man, and you don't edit it out, I'm gonna hold it against you, man.
What's that?
If I lash out during this interview and just get to screaming out and shit and snapping, if you don't edit it out, I'm gonna hold it against you, man.
No, man, as long as you ain't doing it against me. No, I'm like, man, what, am I pulling some cords right now? What's going on? I know your shoulder hurt, but damn, brother, don't take it out on me, man. I'm just trying to make a dollar out of 15 cents. I was going to say, did you hear about this thing where I just heard that they're trying to get R. Kelly's royalties to go to his so-called his alleged victims or whatever. They're trying to pay the victims his royalties. And when I heard that, I'm like, what? You know, what? Have you heard of that?
Yeah, one of them even lost the lawsuit recently a couple months ago for trying to get his royalties, but it's their way of basically trying to take ownership of his catalog. You know, he got a catalog that's worth like $1.2 billion, and that's what this really all about. You know, that's what Michael Jackson's situation was all about,
right?
You know, it's the same ball game. It's all about money and control.
Yeah, that sound, I mean, when I heard that, I'm like, that doesn't make any type of sense whatsoever. That, I mean, come on. No, I think it was the Breakfast Club that spoke about that, but yeah. That was crazy.
Well, about the Breakfast Club, you know, Charlemagne, the God, I don't know why you call this God, you know, act like one, you know. I believe history that the black man was the guys and all. Where I'm getting at is that he was on Surviving R. Kelly saying things bad about R. Kelly, but he got a sex case.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah, what do you think about that?
I mean, he a hypocrite, bro. Like, how you bashing R. Kelly sexually molested a young girl? You know what I mean? That's what I don't be about people, bro. Like, everybody who bashing him, like, even a lot of the females who might be my age or older, like, most of them, y'all was messing with older dudes, grown dudes, when y'all was probably 14, 15. I know because I see this shit going on. I seen it going on when I was young.
Right, you know right.
And I know some females personally who I know, when we was both 14, you was messing with somebody 25, so.
Yeah, yeah.
You ain't never said nothing bad about him, so.
Yeah. Yeah, it's mixed. It's crazy because, you know, it doesn't make it right, but you what you're saying is true. What you're saying is absolutely true. I won't call any, you know, because people might be watching this. I'll just say I saw personally a 14-year-old girl or maybe 13-year-old girl in school dating a 18-year-old boy, a senior. It was a seventh grader dating a senior. I saw this in school, and nobody said anything. The teachers didn't say anything. You know, nobody said anything. So I know what you're saying, man. It don't make it right, but it's there. It's there. You know,
my point is just like that situation, for example, like if we seeing this and we got such a problem about it, why don't we do something about the problem where we see it at? You know what I'm saying? Why we make why we let the media manipulate us so much to come down so hard on R. Kelly when we not saying about the people who doing it around us. You know what I mean?
That's absolutely true. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It just don't make no sense.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Now, I got to talk about the Leah thing. I know you've heard about it 1,000 times, but I just want to see if I can get, I'm not going to, I saw one interview where the guy was trying to like really, really push you hard to say something. But did he speak to you about Aaliyah at all? I mean, did I get the smile again.
You talking about Doggy Diamonds interview?
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Doggy Diamonds. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, he kept going. I mean, I'm like, damn, goodness gracious. He just kept going and going and like trying to get something. But I'm not going to do all that. Did he say anything to you about Aaliyah? You know, because Aaliyah was, that was our princess. You know what I mean?
I mean, he just did it. The whole marriage thing was a publicity stunt from her uncle, Barry Henderson, who was her manager. Other than that, no. And, the same dude, Barry Henderson, Aaliyah's uncle, Aaliyah's manager.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he got $90 million after her death. And,
90 million.
Yeah, so that was supposed to be a scheme. You know what I mean? R. Kelly was kind of hurt about that, though. His name, Aaliyah was cool. But from what he tell me, they was never like having like sexual relations. And the marriage was a publicity stunt. And I believe that because they never produced a real marriage certificate. You know, they tried to come up with one during the trial, but the one that they came up with didn't have no signatures. It didn't have a Leah signature or R. Kelly signature. And from what I'm knowing, I've never been married, but everybody who I know that is legally married, they both had to sign these documents or whatever. So it don't make sense, you know? So I believe them.
Right, right. Okay. So, you know, like you're like really advocating for this guy, man. Like, what do you want to see from all of this? Like, do you want to see some type of justice for him? You want the cases to be reopened? What are you trying to get from all of this? Like advocating for him, because I know he can't do much for you, so it can't be that. So I mean, it got to be something a little bit deeper, from my opinion. What do you want to see from all of this? Like going on these different interviews and speaking on his behalf and things.
Well, before I knew R. Kelly, I've been advocating for black inmates. If you look at the 60th issue of the Don Diva magazine, I had an article in there. My campaign was based on freeing black inmates. If you read my books that was published 2012, I first published the Holy Trap Scriptures, that's one of my books. If you read that, you will see that I've been on black empowerment and advocating for black inmates. So what I'm doing is not all about R. Kelly. It's not even, my movement is not focused on R. Kelly. Just that's what all the bloggers want to bring up in my interview. My movement is for all black inmates.
Okay.
I'm trying to free over 100,000 black inmates.
Okay.
You know what I mean? R. Kelly happened to be a black inmate. So since people want to use R. Kelly as the topic of discussion, I'm using him as the topic of discussion, you know, strategic, to shine light on how unjust and corrupt his case is, so then I can shine light on how unjust and corrupt another 100,000 cases revolving around black men, you know, is. You know, my case, for example, I was framed as a member of a drug trafficking organization for refusing to work for the DEA as an informant. And this goes on. Nobody got the courage to speak out about it like me. You know what I mean? Like, I just got shot. It could be because of that. You know what I'm saying? I was framed and had to do time for something I didn't do. I'm still speaking out because I'm passionate about this, bro. Like, I know what I went through as a black man, and I have best friends. Like, one of my best friends, shout out to Lamar Miller, my nephew. Shout out to him, Prairie Kelly. They locked up, or they shouldn't be locked up, bro. So I'm passionate about that. And me seeing Kelly case and seeing that he was framing these things, you know, I'm speaking out about that. No, but people don't want to hear about Robert Lamar Miller because they don't know him. But everybody know R. Kelly. So when I speak about how they did R. Kelly, the world want to hear that. They don't want to hear about my best friend case because to them it's like, who is he? But right. R. Kelly is a good topic of discussion. So my movement, my agenda is, it really don't have much to do with R. Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
But since everybody want to make him a topic of discussion.
I get what like, you're saying. Yeah. Huh? I get what you're saying. I get exactly what you're saying. Yeah. Sometimes you got to, in order to push your movement forward, you got to jump on something else because that's the thing. That's the vehicle that you're using, basically. Absolutely. We spoke about Jay-Z a little bit, man, and R. Kelly. I never knew. I knew they had a beef, but I never knew it was so deep. What can you tell us about Jay-Z and R. Kelly beef? And is Jay-Z like a part of like the Illuminati and all this type of stuff? Do you believe in that type of stuff? And what can you tell us about all that, man?
Well, I'm the type of person, I don't like to confirm nothing without like proof or you know, confirmation from somebody,
right?
You know who. R. Kelly is somebody who was involved in that industry. So if anybody would know, he would know because nobody in the music industry has ever been as big as R. Kelly. You know what I mean? He's kind of like a Michael Jackson or even Jackie. He's pretty big, you know, but his music catalog is like near as worth as an R. Kelly or a Michael Jackson catalog. But I asked R. Kelly about, you know, Jay-Z and his relationship with Jay-Z. And he explained that they fell out on a Best of Both Worlds tour. And he sued Jay-Z after that for $70 million. And, you know, Jay-Z vindictive towards R. Kelly after that. And, you know, Jay-Z girlfriend, Dream is the executive of Surviving R. Kelly. So R. Kelly fell out Jay-Z. Funded that and was behind that. And I asked him about other things, and you know, as far as Illuminati sacrifices, you know, he don't identify the people as the that's more like a public perception of how people perceive these organizations. They actually do exist. Maybe they do go under these titles, Illuminati or whatever, but yeah, they do exist. R. Kelly confirmed that, and he confirmed that Jay-Z basically a sellout, and you know, he one of their puppets. He do whatever they tell him, you know, for money, other benefit, you know, power, you know. Basically, right. That about sum that up, I guess.
Right. Got two more questions for you, man. I'm gonna close it out, man. Favorite R. Kelly song, man. What's your favorite R. Kelly song?
Heaven, I Need a Hug.
Heaven, I Need a Hug.
Try to get you to remember it and go, Heaven, I Need a Hug. Is it anybody out there willing to embrace a thug?
Okay.
Is it a lot of change your heart? But all I really need is a sign or a word from God.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I remember that.
I had him sing that with me a couple of times. You know
okay,
I mean?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, yeah. That's the song right there. I mean, if you're incarcerated, that's probably everybody's favorite song. You know. Oh man. My last question, man. Milwaukee. Now, I've had some friends. You know, I was in the military. And I had a couple buddies who were from Wisconsin, Milwaukee area, and them boys tell me Milwaukee, y'all get busy over there, man. That's true, right?
Yeah, it's listed as one of the most dangerous cities in America.
Yeah.
It's listed higher. It's more dangerous than Chicago. People hear a lot about Chicago, but
yeah.
I think St. is number one. I think Memphis is ahead of us, but Milwaukee is higher up on the list than Chicago. I think Chicago, you know, with that being the third biggest city in America, I think that's why they get more recognition than us. But
Yeah, it go down
out here, bro. It's like a jungle sometimes, you know.
Yeah. You don't hear a lot about Milwaukee in the news, like say Memphis. Lately, Memphis just you know, Chicago, of course. But wow, yeah, I didn't know Chicago was that bad. But you know, Milwaukee, I didn't know it was that bad. But you know, one of these days I want to go and visit. Get me some cheese over there, you know.
just call me for you. I'll tell you the places, you know, you might want to avoid and the places be good at. Anywhere in Milwaukee, I'm good at, you know, man. But, you know, sometimes, I don't know where you from, but if I was to come near you, most of y'all could tell, like, he out of town. He came from you.
Yeah.
Just by the way you dress or
yeah,
how you talk.
Talk, everything. Yeah. I'm in the Carolinas, man. But, yeah, mostly, yeah, I understand what you're saying. I could tell if a person is out of town or not. Yeah.
And here it's like, we don't got no real beef with, like, other cities, but it's like Chicago, like Milwaukee and Chicago, it's not even really no beef. It's just like, you know, back in the day, Chicago people used to come here thinking this just some soft town.
Right. Some, yeah. Okay.
They have to find out the hard way and get back to Chicago. So when we see people come here from Chicago, it's like we on defense now. We got to let them know off back end.
Right.
Sometimes, you know, these youngins will let them know in a bad way. You know, they might let them know with a gunshot, man.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, man, hey, I hope you, you know, continue doing what you're doing, brother. Salute to you. Have you seen 13th Amendment yet on Netflix, Ava DuVernay?
No, that sounds interesting.
Well, it's called 13th. It's on Netflix, man. You got to see that, man. Seriously. It's going to break down all the statistics on black men in prison in the United States, imprisonment worldwide. You know, the United States is like, we're like number one in the most people in prison in the world. And Ava DuVernay, man, she does a great job putting that together. Barack Obama's in it. It came out maybe 6 or 7 years ago, but I've seen it about 5 or 6 times, man, maybe 7 times. You know, every time I start, you know, I have a conversation like this, I go and I watch it again just to feed my soul, man, and just to keep me on point as far as knowing who I am as a black man and where I could be, you know what I mean? Because I got a lot of family members in prison and whatnot, too. Well, not so many family members these days, but I got a lot of friends and whatnot in prison. You got to check that one out, man.
I'm definitely going to check that out. It's crazy you brought that up because, like I said, I just did an interview before I did this with you, and I was talking about on a hip hop uncensored platform. You know, I allowed them to put out my new book for free on their website.
Okay.
And in the book, it's a bonus chapter. It's actually one of my real lawsuits that I filed in the United States government for basically how they violating our. You know, people only know about civil rights. Human rights fall into the jurisdiction of the world court. It shows how black men or blacks in general are targeted over here.
Right.
So I break all that stuff down, you know, about every amendment, the 13th Amendment, 5th, 14th Amendment. Mm. And it is deep. So, It's just like ironic that you brought that up, but
yeah.
You know, since hip hop, should they support me and you? I think your followers should go check out the interview and look into that petition that I put out. They gotta go on hiphopuncensored.com to get the document I'm talking about.
Okay, you know? Yeah, I'll post their website in the description box. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely. But that documentary, 13th, man, it's powerful, man, because a lot of everyday people don't realize how many black men, black and brown men, are in prison. You know, it's modern day slavery. It's absolutely modern day slavery. Prison reform, we can't get enough of it right now. I mean it's not even, they're not even scratching the surface as far as looking at the situation with so many black men in prison. That's my opinion, you know.
Yeah, I detail that in that petition. So when they go on hiphopun.com and download the book, they, you know, we, a lot of us talk about the problems, mm-hmm. but we don't talk about the solutions. But when they get the book, they gonna see the problem that slavery actually never ended. It's just been modernized. But they gonna also see the solutions about what we could do about it.
Right, absolutely. Well, salute to you, brother. We've been talking for 40 minutes, man. You are my official first interview. So I'm going to go ahead and put this out. And I got to say, anybody else that want to, want to holler at me, just go to the description box and check out my email. Send me an email and I'll see if I can put you on. You know, that's why I'm here. Yeah.
It's an honor. It's an honor. I'm your first interview. I didn't know that, but it's an honor. I'm going to keep that in mind and I'm gonna make sure everybody who should hear this interview, I'm gonna make sure they hear it. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You made the 40 minutes seem like 4 minutes, man.
Yeah, it flew by, but I ran out of questions. I had some questions written down. Yeah.
I'm glad you got out of here quick though, because my arm really aching, bro.
Okay.
I want to get this out the way because I think we probably did this last week.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I'm glad I got to it.
Yeah, last Saturday, and somebody emailed me and said, you got shot. I'm like, what? Oh, my God. I thought the worst, you know. But,
yeah.
I'm glad you're okay, brother.
Okay. You all take right. care.
Salute to you, man.
Yep.
All right. Till next time. What it do, what it do. This is your boy, Anthony Kelly, coming to you live. This is your writer, Anthony L. Kelly, right here. Check it out. These are my books. Mac, Zsa Zsa, Sunshine. And this is my first book published, Saving Miss Carolina. And this is my latest, Illmatic. Go check this book out, man. This is a nod at hip-hop on its 50th anniversary. This is a nod to one of the illest MCs to ever do it, Nasir Jones. This is me shedding the light on mental illness. Mental illness, especially in the black community, is a problem. He's going through some things, man, with his girlfriend back at home here in South Carolina. He's been blown up in Iraq, Afghanistan, shot at. I'll leave all the links in the description box. Salute to everybody who's ever supported me, man. Y'all go support your boy, Anthony L. Kelly. Check till next time. I'm out.